Hello, welcome to the Submarine Force Museum. I'm Commander Brad Boyd, Director of the Museum, and Officer in Charge of Historic Ship Nautilus. Today, we're going to continue our discussion on the Mark 14 torpedo, focusing on the design issues and production woes that plague this torpedo. Now, the Mark 14 torpedo was both an incredible success and an incredible failure. The U.S. Submarine Force during World War II was responsible for nearly two-thirds of all Japanese merchants sunk and nearly one-third of all Japanese warships sunk by the entire United States. So some incredible successes. However, had the torpedo worked correctly since the start of the war, those numbers would have been more, and we probably would have lost less American submarines, as their position wouldn't have been given away by faulty torpedo shots. And in a couple of cases, torpedoes had actually circled around and blew up their own submarine. So some incredible failures at the same time. Now in 1931, as we talked about last episode, when the Navy decided they needed a new torpedo, they only had about $143,000 to put towards this development, which is about $2.4 million in today's money. Not a lot when you're talking about the development of a brand new weapon system, which includes all the testing. And it was $10,000 per torpedo, which is about $172,000 in today's money. So if you detonated one of the torpedoes or lost one of the torpedoes, that was a $10,000 cost to the program. When you're only dealing with $143,000 to begin with, that adds up fast. So there wasn't a lot of testing that was done. In fact, there was no testing done with an actual explosive on board. All done with exercise shots. So they're testing the torpedoes, and they talked to the CNO, and the CNO approved for the torpedoes to be shot at two ships. And I say ships, I mean hulks. They're decommissioned ships. There's going to be no crew on board. They have, you know, no fuel on board, no oil on board, no weapons on board, no food on board. You get the idea. And it's just towed in position, let floating there, and you shoot the torpedoes at it. The conditions were there could be no explosives on the torpedo, so the torpedo couldn't blow the ship up. No, and if the torpedo happened to strike the ship and just punch a hole in it by just hitting it, then any damage to that, if it caused the ship to sink, the Bureau of Ordnance, who's responsible for developing the torpedoes, would have to pay to refloat the ship. This is a little surprising since both ships that were identified were scheduled to be sunk at sea later that year, and they were. So it's a little surprising that it went that way, but as a result, these torpedoes never actually had a live fire test onto a ship. So the Mark 14 went into full production and wartime use without full testing ever being done upon it. To compound this, the exploder used, the Mark 6 exploder, was a magnetic influence detector. We talked about that last episode, and the first of its kind. And the Navy was so terrified that it would be leaked to or planned stolen by a potential adversary, that when they wrote the manual for it, they refused to print it. So they only wrote one, it never made more than one. And they locked it in safe for no one to ever see, so that to ensure complete secrecy of the program, of the exploder. So that didn't allow submariners to come up with tactics for use of this new exploder mechanism, how best to employ torpedoes or anything else. And it was trial by fire come World War II. Next major issue is procurement. Now this is an issue that plagued the Navy back to World War I. There just wasn't an adequate industrial base for the torpedo. And I don't mean that there wasn't an adequate industrial base in America. I mean, no one had been tapped. It was only one company that was really tapped to make torpedoes, and they just didn't have the production capacity. In World War I, it was E.W. Bliss, and they could make a maximum of about 250 torpedoes a year if they did nothing else. And their primary job was actually artillery shells. And so they only made about 20 torpedoes a year throughout World War I. And then eventually the government decided that, hey, about 1920, 1921, they gave them a $2 million loan, the E.W. Bliss company, a $2 million loan, which is about $38.5 million today, to expand their production facilities. And then about 1923, they decide, hey, we're done. No outside contractors are allowed. There's one place that's going to be allowed to make torpedoes, and that's going to be Naval Torpedo Station Newport in Newport, Rhode Island. And they're to be the sole designer, builder, and tester of all torpedoes for the Navy, to include all submarine torpedoes. So you have one organization that's designed for absolutely every aspect of the torpedo, and no independent organization to come check up on them, make sure they're doing what they're supposed to be doing and everything's functioning the way it's supposed to be functioning. What could go wrong, right? So But that kicks off, and by 1938, Newport was so behind in production, because they could only make 1.5 torpedoes a day with 3,000 workers working 3 shifts a day, that the Navy expanded the production aspect to Alexandria, Virginia, and Keyport, Washington, the torpedo stations there. So, but upon entering World War I, they still weren't meeting production quota, so the combined 3 sites were supposed to make 50 per day, and they could only make 23 at best. So the Navy eventually said, okay, we're going to expand out again, and they go into the private sector, and they go to the American Can Company, which was a tin company throughout America, and contracted with them to make torpedoes. And then in 1942, they contracted with Westinghouse Electric Corporation to design and build what became the Mark 18 electric torpedo. So, unsurprisingly, the United States entered the war with far fewer torpedoes in inventory than it wanted. And now this did not help 3 days after the war officially started for the United States. So December 7th was the attack at Pearl Harbor in 1941. December 10th, we lost 233 Mark 14 torpedoes during an attack by the Japanese, an air raid on Cavite Naval Yard in the Philippines. So now that's not, you know, a major issue, it's just a small contributing factor, but it didn't help it matters any at all. But production issues would plague the submarine force until spring of 1945. And finally, production levels actually exceeded by a fair amount the rate of fire, and we could actually bring inventory back up as opposed to shipping a torpedo and immediately loading on a submarine and submarines going to sea with potentially not even a full loadout because we just didn't have the inventory on hand prior to commencing a war patrol. So, but I hope you enjoyed today's episode. Next one, we'll go into some of the controversy with the Mark 14. So once it saw action in World War II, some of the issues that was found by the actual submariners and the problems with trying to resolve it. If you have any questions, please let us know. With that, bye.